Hello, and today we're going to talk about creating a communications plan for your church. This is the first in a series that will probably run 14 or 15 parts. There's a lot of information to cover in creating a communications plan, so that's why I'm breaking down into smaller chunks. But today we're going to begin by talking about marketing. I want to talk about why we must market. And that's because if we don't, we become irrelevant, and I'll explain that. Let's look at what's at stake first before we get into too much on the definition of marketing. According to the Barna Research Group, since 1970, there has been no growth in the proportion of adults who attend church. And by that I mean that while the number of adults attending church has increased, our population has also increased. So as a percentage, there aren't any more adults attending church now than there were back in the 70s. Also, since 1980, there's been no growth in the proportion of people who describe themselves as born-again Christians. There was a revival movement during the early 70s, and things were on the upswing. But since 1980, the number of people who describe themselves as born-again Christians, again, has increased numerically, but as a percentage of the population, hasn't changed. And also, another factor in that is while more people are attending church, the fastest-growing churches are non-Christian. And a growing number of adults lack confidence in church as an institution, which is why maybe some people attend church, but they don't describe themselves as born-again Christians. They don't want to be associated with a label that, you know, the media and other institutions have created about what it means to be a Christian. And going back to my statement that the church is becoming irrelevant, by that I don't mean that our, you know, our mission, the reason that we exist hasn't become irrelevant. If anything, it's more relevant than ever. But some of the things that churches used to do in relationship to that mission, we've become irrelevant because there are other service organizations that are doing our missional work. And by that I mean that going back over the centuries, churches used to, well, going back to the very early church, it was the Christian church that created the concept of a hospital. And now we have hospitals all over the place. Churches used to provide training and schooling. Now we have public schools, private schools, some people are homeschooling. Churches used to be on the forefront of providing aid when it was needed, soup kitchens, clothing, blankets, temporary housing, jobs training. All of these things now are done either by parachurch organizations, nonprofit organizations, or church agencies, government agencies. So we're becoming irrelevant because the things that we used to be in the forefront of at and used to excel at are now being done by other groups. Also, a church, in addition to serving the community, also used to serve a social focus. The old term ice cream social, a few of us remember that. Maybe you've actually attended one. Church was a place to gather before church and after church to talk about the things of the day. News that was going on, to meet new people, establish relationships, but now there are racquetball clubs, soccer leagues, you've got the internet with Facebook and Twitter. People either are cementing or establishing relationships there through social media. So church is no longer that social hub that it used to be. And also, there are some people who don't care where the relationships are developing because they don't value either belonging to a community or establishing relationships because they're more interested in seeking entertainment. 180 channels of cable, internet available 24/7, all kinds of sports activities to participate in or join. And I'm not saying that any of these things is bad, but the fact is that people are turning to these things oftentimes for passive entertainment because establishing relationships, you know, takes work, and some people just don't want to put forth that effort. So how can marketing help us overcome some of these challenges that we're facing? Marketing can help us better understand our community and its needs, and I'll go into a lot more detail into that later. But again, getting back to that, one of the purposes of the church being to serve its community, if we understand the needs, then we can better define our ministries and we can focus our resources better. Also, marketing can help the members of your church, and not just the members, but also the people attending, develop greater ownership of the ministries that your church has. Marketing can help grow new leaders. It can help de-stress your pastor. I'll go into those things later. And it can give you a new view of how your church fits into the community beyond the services that it provides in terms of outreach and ministry. Marketing will help you, understanding marketing will help you create this communications plan. And the purpose of the communications plan is twofold. First off, it outlines and directs the communication efforts of your church. And by that, I'm talking about not just the marketing that you do, banners and road signs, if you do billboards or your web page, but any of the activity, and I'll get into more detail, how you can empower the members of your church to help participate in the communications plan and putting forth the mission and goals of your church. Communication plans can also help congregations think strategically about goals, about the things that you're trying to accomplish. Okay, so hopefully I've laid the groundwork to understand why marketing is important, what's at stake, and what we need to do, some idea of what we need to do. But now I want to look at, if marketing is so important, why don't churches market well? And it primarily comes down to people perception. Let's look at your senior pastor or the teaching staff at your church. They've been trained in Greek, they've been trained in Hebrew, church history, possibly counseling. They haven't been trained in communications, marketing, statistical analysis, advertising, and all of these other, web technology, website design, print design, all these things that are facets of a communications plan, they're not trained in. And oftentimes it falls on their shoulders. And when it doesn't fall on their shoulders, it gets delegated to an elder, a deacon, or some volunteer to lead this effort. So you run into the time crunch. Because what happens when you empower a volunteer to take on communications, first off, that's great, because that might be their passion, that might be their giftedness. But the downside is that they have a life outside the church. They might have a job, they might have a home to maintain. That means they might have children that they're helping with homework, taking to different sporting events or other activities at school. They've got a home to take care of. They've got family and friends that they need to spend time with. So the amount of time that they can afford to spend on communications, which requires a dedicated effort, can be very small. And then eventually you can also run into the problem of funding your marketing efforts. And marketing can become a very expensive proposition. It also, there are ways to mitigate some of those costs or eliminate them or definitely reduce them, but without some training and background in this, oftentimes money can be spent either on things that aren't needed or more money is spent than is necessary. There's also the perception that we have. People confuse marketing with sales. I might have said that earlier, but sales, which is often seen as high pressure and oftentimes untrustworthy. You get that image in your mind of the used car salesman in the plaid polyester suit, and people think that's their vision of sales, and they think that's also marketing. And marketing is, sales is just one component of marketing, but marketing encompasses a lot more. We'll dive into that as we go through the rest of these presentations. Also, there's the perception of marketing is not a religious activity because it doesn't meet people's needs. It doesn't serve them. It doesn't help them with either spiritual or emotional healing. It doesn't put food on their table. It doesn't provide them with jobs training or get them involved in a community. So marketing isn't a religious activity, and we shouldn't be doing it. And again, I'll demonstrate how marketing actually supports all of those efforts. The other perception is, we don't need to do marketing because we're already doing it. We have a website or we rented a billboard somewhere. And let me say that if you were to take the marketing process, developing a church communications plan and divide it into 12 steps, creating your website or building your billboard, that's like step 9 and 10 down the road. So having a website, okay, that's great and you can do wonderful things with it. But don't confuse it with thinking that completes your marketing effort. If anything, it's something that you're going to come back and revisit and probably redo as you develop this communications plan. Then there's the stick your head in the sand, we don't need to market because we just don't. We're awesome, we're great, we're wonderful, and we don't need to market. And fortunately, there are very, very few churches or nonprofit organizations I've ever worked with or run into who have that attitude. But Actually, I've never run into it, but I've heard from other consultants that I've worked with that perception does exist. All right, let's wrap this up. So what we talked about was marketing, what it is. We spent a lot of time talking about what it isn't. We talked about people's perceptions about marketing, how they often view it as unnecessary, that it's not a religious activity, how people confuse marketing with sales, and really kind of laying the groundwork for the rest of these presentations where we're going to demonstrate that marketing is something that your church is probably already doing, although you call it something different without even realizing it, and that there is a formal process for creating a marketing or communications plan for your church. So, pardon me, to continue with the discussion here, after you've viewed this presentation, if you want to jump on EPC Community, we'll have a discussion group already set aside for that, and this is a place for you to ask questions about this presentation or about marketing in general. You can also leave comments if you're aware of a resource that people might find useful. This is a great place to share that. Also, you can download the slides from this presentation at epc.org. And I've laid out the URL there. Now, I added some spaces to make it a little more readable, so don't put the spaces in when you type it in your browser. That's /EPC.org/CEC/EPC-communicators. So I hope you found this presentation useful. I'm looking forward to your comments and questions on EPC Community. And again, if you've got an idea for a presentation that you would like me to make, or you know me to find a guest speaker for, please go ahead and send me an email on that, and I'd be happy to put that together for you. So until next time, have a great day.